Good morning, everyone, and good morning, very good morning to Chatur, Teja, Deepak, MB Reddy. Good morning, Vahini, Santosh, Anjali. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Swati. Good morning, Satvik. In the previous class, I had given you a question, and I think 2 to 3 students have sent me the solution. Few students were absolutely correct, but few of them were wrong also. So that's why I'm explaining that question very quickly. Okay. So see, where you are getting confusion in such type of problems, although these problems are very simple, so I am now exploring those things where some of you are getting confusion. Okay, so please focus here. Whoever is getting confused in such type of problems, please focus. Okay, question is with you already. In the previous class, I have given you the question, so I am directly giving you the solution. So see the data. And yes, a very good thing is that the students who sent me the solution are making proper notes. That's very nice. That is a very good thing. Deepak is absolutely correct. Your answer is absolutely correct. See, the question was containing 3 sets. Quickly, I'm doing it. And after that, I will move to the next one. As I told you that today we have to start what? Inequality. This is very important and very interesting. The data was provided for total 175 students. Okay. And these students were distributed in 3 subjects. 3 subjects were math, physics, and chemistry. And that's why I'm making 3 sets. Math, physics, and chemistry. Okay. It is math, it is physics, and it is chemistry. See, as I told you in the previous questions, which I solved in the class, listen carefully. I told you to start the filling of this Venn diagram from the innermost portion. Yes, everyone, I think, remember. I told you to fill this Venn diagram from the innermost portion. Innermost portion is this. That means this represents the students who study math, physics, and chemistry all. The students who study math, physics, and chemistry, all the subjects. And it is given in the question, the data was 18. Okay, nice. So this place has been filled by, I think, all of you. Now see, where some of you are getting confused, please focus here. Where some of you are getting confused. Now go back to the previous data. Here it is given that physics and chemistry 23. Physics and chemistry given as 23. So see here, everyone, please focus. Whoever is getting confused in such type of problems, please focus. Physics and chemistry total combined is 23. So see everyone, physics and chemistry is this much. I am drawing it with different colors so that you may be able to understand it in a very clear way. See, physics and chemistry total represents this. The blue colored part represents physics and chemistry total. Okay, so total physics and chemistry is 23. Here already 18 is there. So that's why remaining 5 will be filled at this place. Remaining 5 will be filled at this place. So now tell me, is this point clear to you or not? Please tell me quickly. Is this point clear to you or not? especially G Chaturutheja, tell me, is it clear or not? Okay. Yes. Okay, good. Now see, the previous data was math and chemistry 28. Math and chemistry 28. So everyone please focus. Math and chemistry is this much. See, this total represents math and chemistry. It is total 28. So how much I have to put here? 18 and 10. Yes, correct. Now Chatur, you are correct now. And now I think you can do it. And the previous data was math and physics. Math and physics was provided 30. So math and physics, see, it is 30 total. It is total 30. So here 18, and that's why here, yes, 12, correct. Now, again, go back to the previous data. In chemistry, total 46. So see, now come back to the chemistry. Total 46. So 18 plus 10, 28. 28 plus 5, 33. And 33, and how much you have to put here so that the total becomes 46? Yes, it is 13. Correct. Now, go back to the previous data. Physics was 70. So physics 70. So now come back to the physics. 18 and 20 becomes 30, 35. So here, yes, 35 will come. Yes. And lastly, in math, there were total 100. So now add all, addition of all these must be 100. So 18 and 12, 30 plus 10, 40, and it is 16. Now you are able to answer all the questions. The first question was, how many students were studying math alone? Okay, so yes, you can tell me the answer. Math alone, 60. 60 students study math alone, yes. Yes, correct everyone. Yes, now you are correct. The second question is, what was the second question? How many students do not study any subject? So Deepak has got the answer 4, and I think that answer is correct. But Deepak, do you know what you have done to get the number of students who do not study any subject? You have applied the formula for M union P union C and done all these things. But do you know you don't need to apply the formula, etc. Just assume X, the number of students who do not study any subject. And addition of all these must be total 175. So addition of all these must be 75. So let's add all these. So see, inside math, there are total 100. So I am directly adding all these as 100. Plus C, 35 plus 5. I am directly, okay, right. 35 plus 5 and plus 13 and plus X, and that is 175. Now 140, 150, 153. So X is equal to what? 175 minus how much? It is 153. Okay. So what is the correct answer? The correct answer is 22. Okay. So there are 22 students who do not study any subject. I think there is calculation mistake with you, Deepak. I think in second part, you have done only calculation mistake. You can check it. So the correct answer for the second part becomes 22. Okay. So now is it clear or not? Please say quickly so that I can move to the next concept. Okay. Okay, very nice. So I'm giving you the chance to ask your doubts from the DPP. If you have any doubts in any problem of the DPP, then you can ask me, you can tell me the question number. I will explain that question to you. And after that, I am going to start inequality. Yes. So if you have any doubt, please tell me, ask me quickly. Do you have any doubt? Have you solved the DPP? Okay, Nagesh is asking for question number 10. So everyone, please open your DPP number 3 and come to the question number 10. I'm also opening the DPP. DPP question number 10. Nagesh, am I right? You are asking for question number 10 in DPP 3. Yes or no? Okay, see the question number 10. Okay, it is language based question. Everyone, please read the question. In a town of 10,000 families, it was found that 40% people buy newspaper A. So total, how much people were the hours into total 10,000 families. Okay. 10,000 families. Total where there were in a town. 40% of family buy newspaper A. So newspaper A. How many family come in the newspaper A? Can you calculate? Yes, it can be calculated very easily. It is 40% of the 10,000. How you evaluate 40% of 10,000? Very simple. 10,000 multiplied by 40 divided by 100. So you are getting 4,000. So see, 4,000 people, so 4,000 families are reading newspaper A. So you just put NA is equal to 4,000. Okay, now. Tejasvi, sorry, I forgot to save the PDF of the previous class. So you can ask for the notes from any other students. Okay. I think Deepak or other students have noted down the previous class, so they can send you the notes of the previous class. Today, I will definitely not forget to save the DPPs. Okay. Yes, Veronica, you are correct. Sorry for that, because I often forget to save the PDF, to save the whiteboard. Today, I will not forget. For the yesterday's class, you can contact any other students, or I will ask some students to send me the PDF and I will send that PDF in the group. Okay. So sorry for the previous class. From the next time, I will take care of these things. Don't worry. Okay, next. So NA becomes 4,000. Now, what about next? 20% buy newspaper B. So newspaper B. Newspaper B. 20%. So how much it becomes? 10,000 into 20 divided by 100. So it is 2,000. Okay, now next. Yes. 10% of family buy newspaper C. So newspaper, so NB, you will just write 2,000. And similarly, I'm directly writing NC is equal to 1,000, because 10% of the families read newspaper C. Now come to the next data. Students are regularly joining the class. They are so late. The class starts at sharp 10 a.m. See, next, 5% families buy A and B. So NA intersection B is equal to how much it will be? Yes, 500. I think you can evaluate how much 5% will be. You know the how to calculate 5% of 10,000. So I am not calculating for every data. I am directly writing how much 5% will be. It will be 10,000 multiplied by 5 divided by 100. So you will get 500. Now, next data. 3% by B and C. So N, B intersection C, B and C, 3% means 300. Next. 4% by A and C. So N A intersection C is equal to 400. Correct, Santosh. Very nice. If 2% families buy all the three newspapers, so 2% families buy all the newspapers A and B and C, it is 2% means 200. Then what you are being asked? The number of families which buy A only is. So number of families which buy A, see, total 1,000 families, all the data have been given to you. And the question, in the question, it is being asked that, what? The number of families which buy A only, this is being asked from you. Tell me, which method will be easier for you? Formula or Venn diagram? Yes, give me the answer quickly. Formula or Venn diagram? Venn diagram, correct. Not formula. Although this question can be done by formula also. Easily it can be done by formula also. But this question can be done by Venn diagram in a more easier way. Yes, correct. Santosh Dixit, you all are correct. Because, see, the innermost data has been provided to you. And that's why it is better to solve this question by Venn diagram. So quickly, I am drawing the Venn diagram. So please focus, everyone. There are three newspapers, or you can say three sets, A, B, and C. A, B, and C. Fill the innermost data first. That means A intersection B intersection C, which is 200. And move in the backward direction. Please, everyone, and A intersection C is 400. See, A intersection C is 400. So here 200 already is there, and that's why 200 remaining will be here. Go to the previous data. B intersection C is 300. So B intersection C is 300. So here 100. Again, go to the previous data. A intersection B is 500. So A intersection B is 500 means 300 will come here. Again, go back to the previous data. NC is 1000. So now total in C will be 1000, 2 to 400, 100, 500. Remaining 500 will be here. Go back to the previous data. NB is equal to 2000. Now come to NB, 2000. 3 to 500, 600, and here 1400. So that the total becomes 2000. Now, lastly, come to A. NA is equal to 4000. And here, total will be 4000. So 3 to 500 to 700. And here 3300. So now you can directly answer that number of families who study only newspaper A is 3300. So I think it is clear. It is clear to all. Now come to the next question. One student was asking for 39, Manikanta. So everyone, please come to question number 39 of your DPP very quickly. And if anyone has any else doubt, he can send me in the message, okay? So that I can explain the doubts, and after this we'll start our new topic, a new subtopic. See, what is the question? 39, in a battle, 70% of the combatants lost one eye. Okay, 80% an ear, 75% an arm, 85% a leg, X percent lost all the four limbs. The minimum value of X is, yes. Okay, so Deepak, you send me the question. Okay, no problem. I have to look at the question in the mobile. Okay, so that's why I was looking at the question, but no problem. See, here four sets are there. Just write them. 70% of the cast. So total, first of all, you can write total. Total will be 100. Because the data is given in percentage. Now see, 70% of the combatant lost one eye. So I will write NI. I'm representing it by capital E. So it is 70% means I'm writing 70. Now see, 80% an ear. Okay, so ear is also, ear also starts with E. So let's write it by EA. Okay. Next. So number of people who lost an ear is 80. Next. 75% an arm. So let's write NA is equal to 75. And lastly, 85% leg. So N leg is equal to 85%. Now, what is being asked in the question? X percent lost all the four limbs. So X percent lost all the four limbs. Eye and ear and arm and leg. All four limbs are lost by X percent of the people. So you have to find the minimum value of X. Okay, you have to find the minimum value of x. Okay, so let's do it. Venn diagram is not possible to draw for the four sets. Okay, so that's why I'm solving it in a different way. Okay, now see how to solve it. Here, N E intersection I intersection ear, intersection arm intersection leg. We have to find its minimum value. So let's assume this E intersection EA as one set and this A intersection L as the second set. Okay. So now let's apply the formula for these two sets, I intersection ear. One more thing I can write is, if I combine all, then it will come out as 100. Okay, there are a total 100 number of combatants. So just wait a minute. I am doing it by union, E union EA. Okay. So N E union E A. Let's evaluate it. Okay. You know it is N E plus N E A minus N E intersection E A. Now I need to get the minimum value of E intersection EA. I need to get the minimum value of E intersection EA. So the minimum value of E intersection EA will be if I put the maximum value of E union EA. Okay. And the maximum value of E union EA can be what? If I combine these two, then its maximum value can be 100. Its maximum value can be not 80, it can be 100. If I combine both of these, then the maximum value can be 100. The total number of combatants, its maximum value it can be. So NE is 70 plus NEA is 80 minus here I will get the minimum value of E intersection EA. So NE intersection EA, its minimum value will be 150 minus 100, it will be 50. Similarly, if I evaluate A union L, it will be NA plus NL minus NA intersection L. To evaluate its minimum value, I will put its maximum, and these two combined maximum can be 100. So again, let's put all the data. NA is 75, NL is 85. So what is the minimum value of NA intersection L? This is 160 minus 100, so it is 60. Okay, so its minimum value is 50, its minimum value is 60. Now we have to get the minimum value of this intersection this. Okay. Minimum value of, yes, minimum value of this intersection this. I need to get C, I need to get the minimum value of E intersection EA. Let's consider it as P intersection A intersection L. Let's consider it as Q. So I need to get the minimum value of P intersection Q. And you have studied that the minimum number of elements in P intersection Q, generally it becomes zero. But in one case, I told you that it will not be zero if sum of both these is greater than universal set. So here, sum of both these is 110, which is greater than the universal set. So its minimum value you will evaluate by the formula. And I can directly tell you the answer. It is 110. So the minimum value of NP intersection Q will be 10 only. Okay, everyone, please focus here. The question was a little difficult. No doubt the question was a little tricky. But in this way, you can do this question. If anyone has any doubt, please ask me. Quickly, please ask. Please quickly ask so that I can move forward. I kept the same values of as given in question, but I got the same answer. See, I don't know where you have done the mistake, but you please see the solution, whatever I am providing to you. Please focus here and tell me at what steps you have doubt. Once explain how 10 will come, sir. Yes, I am explaining. See. Okay, very good, Veronica. You have understood, then that is very nice. See everyone, please. All the data have been given. Intersection of all the four sets is X. Minimum value of it is being asked. There is no formula. There is no Venn diagram. Okay. That's why I have to think a little different in this question. So what I did is I converted this problem into the problem of two set. How? I took this E intersection EA as one set and A intersection L as other set. Now, let's evaluate the minimum value of E intersection EA. How to evaluate the minimum value of E intersection EA? By the formula of NE union EA. To get the minimum value of E intersection EA, I just put the maximum value of E union EA, which is 100, universal set. So I got the minimum value of NE intersection EA. Let it is P. In the same way, I got the minimum value of A intersection L, let put it Q, and it is 60. Now I need to get the minimum value of NP intersection Q. So its minimum value can be evaluated by the formula NP union Q is equal to what? NP plus NQ minus NP intersection Q. Okay, so to get its minimum value, I need to put its maximum, which is 100. I need to put its minimum, and we have calculated the minimum of P and Q. The minimum of P is 50 and minimum of Q is 60. Minimum of P is 50, minimum of Q is 60. That's why you got the answer as 10. Now I think, I hope I am clear. Okay. Next question, Manikanta is asking for question number 53. At least I am happy that Manikanta is solving the problems. And what about other students? Either they have not solved the problems. No, I don't put the videos on YouTube. The video is with the management of the K. Venkanna classes. All these videos will be provided to you. Don't worry, all these videos will be provided to you. How and when? For this, you can contact the management of the classes. Okay. You must solve the DPP. Okay. Because I have provided you the DPP to solve this. If you solve this, then at least you will get confidence in this topic. And if question is asked from this topic in any exam, you will be able to solve. Now see, question number 53. Everyone, please see question number 53. Oh. The number of elements in the set. What is the set? A comma B such that 2A square plus 3B square equal to 35. 2a square plus 3b square equal to 35. AB belongs to Z. Z means integer. Integer can be represented by I or Z, as I told you in the number system. Set of all integers, yes, is. So you have to tell me how many elements are there. How many elements AB are there, which satisfies the relation. Which relation? 2a square plus 3b square is equal to 35. Okay. So let's start. See, everyone, please focus. Only one equation, but there are two unknowns. So one equation, two unknown, you can never solve it by mathematics. You have to solve it by hit and trial. As I told you again and again, this thing. One equation, two variable, mathematically you cannot solve. You have to solve it by hit and trial. So let's check. Here I am putting the value of A, and here I will put the value of B. If I put A is equal to 0, can you get any integral value of B? No, because B square will become 35 divided by 3. It is not an integer. Reject it. Put A equal to 1. So 2, 35 minus 2, how much? 33. So 3B square is equal to 33. B square is equal to 11. Again, reject, because the square of an integer cannot become 11. Okay, so again, reject this. Similarly, put A is equal to 2. So if you are putting 2, then 2 square 4 into 2, 8. So 3B square is equal to 35 minus 8. It is 27. Yes, and 3, 9. B square is equal to 9. So B is equal to 3. Or plus minus on both sides can be put, because here A square and B square are there. Now move to the next case. Put A is equal to 3. 9 into 2, 18. So what we will get is 3B square is equal to 35 minus 18. 35 minus 18. 35 minus 18, how much you will get? 17. Okay. So again, it is not possible. Leave it. Come to 4. 32. And here 3b square is equal to 35 minus 32. 3. So yes, b square is 1. So b is equal to plus minus 1. So here just I put plus minus 4 plus minus 1. Now, the next case is not possible, because if you put a is equal to 5, then 2a square will become 50. And it is not possible, because sum of both these is 35 only. So you can calculate how many numbers are there. See, here four sets are there. And four sets are here also. Total is 8. See, Chaturya 8 is the correct answer. See, here total four numbers are there. How? See, 2 comma 3, 2 comma minus 3, minus 2 comma 3, minus 2 comma minus 3. Similarly, four possibilities are here. So 4 and 4 becomes 8. So the correct answer is 8, I think. Yes. Now it is it clear, everyone? Please tell me quickly. Is it clear? Please say yes or no quickly, please. Okay. Anything else we want to ask, or should I start the inequality? Do you want to ask anything else, or should I start the inequality? Tell me quickly. Okay, Nagesh Lingala is asking for question number 50. Okay, see, in the question number 50, Cartesian product of sets is involved. So that's why I am asking you to leave question number 50 only. Leave question number 50, because here Cartesian product of sets is involved, which I am not going to teach you, because this thing is generally not asked in the competitive exam. Okay. So that's why just leave the question number 50. By mistake, it is there in the DPP. Okay. So yes, now. Okay, Hanok is asking for question number 22. Please quickly, as I told you that you will not go back your home with any doubt. So see quickly question number 22. If A and B are any two sets, then A intersection, oh, it is A. I told you in the class, please see your notebook. You can do it by Venn diagram, Hanok. Please look at your class notes. A intersection A union B is simply a very easy question. Okay, class notes, please. Question number 30. Quickly, question number 30. Again, this is the question of class C, question number 30. NA is equal to AN. AN means multiple of natural number. N belongs to natural number. Okay. How can I get DPP, sir? Oh, you are not in the group, MB Reddy. I think you must join the group if you are not in the group. Via your friend, please ask any of your friend to invite you and you please join the group. There you will get DPP. Okay. Yeah. So yes, please focus here. NA is equal to multiple of A. NA means multiple of A. And what are you being asked here in question number 30 is 3N intersection 7N. 3N intersection 7N. See, it is a multiple of 3. It is a multiple of 7. And intersection means the elements which are multiple of 3 and 7 both, the elements which are multiple of 3 and 7 both will be multiple of 21. And I told you again this in the class because you have what I told you, you have to take LCM of 3 and 7. So it is 21N, question number 30. Okay. So next question you people are asking for, question number 42 and 34, okay. See question number 34. You can draw it by Venn diagram. See, question number 34, very quickly do it. You can draw it by Venn diagram. See, A union B union C is equal to universal set. A union B union C is equal to universal set. It is provided in the question, okay? And you can draw the Venn diagram. See, quickly I'm drawing. Everyone please see question number 34. I want to do it very quickly. Although this Venn diagram is not completely correct, but still I think I can explain it. See, here A union B union C is the universal set. That means this rectangle is not the universal set. A union B union C is the universal set. Okay. Now, A minus B, what is A minus B? The number of elements which are present in A, but not present in B. I am putting just dots. You have to take union with B minus C. B minus C means the elements which are present in B but not present in C. So I have put a green dot. I have put green dots here. Now you have to take union. C minus A means elements which are present in C but not present in A. C, blue dots. I am putting blue dots here. And take union and then take complement. So if you take complement of all these, then you will get this. That means A intersection B intersection C you will get. Which option is correct? C option is correct. And I think D is the same one. Okay, so C is the most appropriate. Let's move to the next problem. 42. Okay, I'm moving to question number 42. I think today's class will go in completely for doubts. Let's see question number 42. 20 teachers of a school either teach mathematics or physics. So directly write. 22. Directly write the data. Just wait, I'm moving to question number 56 after 42. 20 teachers of a school either teach math or physics. So I'm writing math or physics means, and math or means union. Okay, I told you the meaning of or is union. Next, 12 of the teach mathematics, while 4 teach both the subject. So NM is equal to 12, math 12 teach mathematics and 4 teach both the subject. So NM intersection P is equal to 4. Okay, these data have been provided in the question. Then the number of teachers teaching physics only. I think it's very, very, very easy. Hano, I think you can do it now. Do you still feel any problem with this question? Very easy question. Math, physics, M intersection P is 4, NM is 12, so here 8, M union P is 20, so here is 8. That's all. Next. Question number 56, Manikanta is asking 56. Which of the following is true statement? Again, I explained in the class. Let's check. See, which one is 56? The first statement is not correct. You know, everyone. Because this is a set and set does not belong to other set. Second statement is correct because it will be a subset of this. I explained it already in the class. Okay, next. 51. Okay, so yes, leave 51 also. Because the question also belongs to the Cartesian product. So two questions, 50 and 51, you just please leave it because this belongs to Cartesian product of two sets. Okay. And you don't need to study the set theory in that way so that it covers Cartesian product. All these you don't need to study. Okay. So that's why these two questions are by mistake in your DPP. You can leave this question now. Manikanta, what you are asking for? Answer of 56 is wrong in answer sheet. Okay, yes. I think 3 is correct in 56 question, 3 not C. Second one is correct in question number 56, option number B is correct. If anything else is provided in the question, that is wrong. No, never. Phi cannot be equal to ABC. How phi can be equal to the set ABC? Phi is null set. It contains no elements. How it can be equal to this set? Never possible. B is correct. Okay. B is correct. If anything else is provided in the answer sheet, then please correct it. B option is correct for question number 56. So now tell me, the doubts are over or still you have some more doubts? Over. Okay. G. Chaturi is asking for the answer of the second question. Okay. So I'm giving you the answer for the second question and then I am going to start inequality. In the second question, it is being asked that which of the following is empty set? In the first set, what is written? X square minus 1 is equal to 0. It is not an empty set. Okay. Welcome to all. And the second X is real number, X square plus 1 is equal to 10. Yes, it is also possible. So it is not an empty set. The third one is also not empty set. And the fourth one, X square is equal to X plus 2. Oh, that is also not. Okay, see, just a minute. Real number, X is real number. Okay. So none of them is empty set. Which of the following is the empty set? None of the given options is an empty set in question number 2. Okay. If the answer is B, I don't know the answer in the answer sheet what is it is being given, but if the answer is B, then please correct the question. X square plus 1 is equal to, make it 0, not 10. In that case, correct answer will be B. Okay, so just please correct question number 2, option number 2, make it X square plus 1 is equal to 0, and in this case, this second option will be correct. It will be an empty set. Okay. So now, yes, okay. Now I'm going to start inequality. Okay. Okay, so now I'm going to start. Please, everyone, be ready. Very interesting and very important. So the wait is over. We are going to start the inequality. Should I start? Ready? Okay. So I'm going to start the inequality in the new page. I am turning the page. Okay. How the time passes in mathematics, we can never feel, because in doubts, it takes so much time to solve the problems. Because in mathematics, we have to solve each and every step. That's why it takes time and the time flies away. Yeah. So now let's start the very important inequality. See, without knowing this inequality, whatever I am going to teach you, you will not be able to study the mathematics. If anyone does not know that how to solve this inequality, then believe me, he will not be able to solve even any one of the topic of the mathematics later on. And that's why this is very important, and it is covered in the basic math, so that after studying this, you may be able to solve the other topics, because the inequality will come in each topic. Don't worry. Okay, so let's start. Now again, before studying the inequality, we have to study some precautions. Very basic thing. Okay, very important and very basic thing. I am telling you, before solving the inequality, before starting the inequality, you must keep some precautions. You must know some precautions, because if you are not careful at these precautions, then even after solving the whole inequality, even after solving the whole question, your final answer will be wrong. So that's why you must know that what are these precautions. Okay. If you don't keep care of these precautions, then again, I'm telling you, even after solving the whole questions, your answer will be wrong. So the first precaution is, avoid cross multiplication. You have to avoid cross multiplication. In inequality, I'm talking about, avoid cross multiplication. I am talking in inequality, okay? In equation, you can cross multiply. You can do the cross multiplication, no problem. But in inequality, you have to avoid cross multiplication. Now, why to avoid cross multiplication? I am going to explain it with a simple, small example. See, if I give you an example that 2 divided by minus 1, it is equivalent to minus 2, and 3. Tell me which one is greater. 2 divided by minus 1 and 3. Which one is greater? Yes, 3. 3 is greater. Yes, 3 is greater. Nice. Now let's multiply minus 1. Let's do the cross multiplication of minus 1. Yes, everyone is correct. 3. Let's do the cross multiplication by minus 1. So here 2. If I multiply by minus 1 to this 3, if I cross multiply this minus 1 with 3, then it will be minus 3. Now, which one is greater? Yes, your answer will be 2 is greater. So see, what is happening here? If I multiply by a negative number, if I cross multiply by a negative number, then the sign of inequality gets changed. Yes, if I cross multiply by a negative number, then sign of inequality change. But suppose if here is 3/2 and 2, which one is greater? Obviously 2 is greater, everyone know. And let's cross multiply by 2. If I cross multiply by 2, then I will get here 3 and here 4. Now which one is greater? Yes, 4 is greater. Here, see everyone, if I multiply by a positive number, if I do cross multiplication by a positive number, then sign of inequality does not change. So what conclusion I am drawing from the both of these two examples? If I cross multiply with a negative number, then sign of inequality will change. But if I multiply with positive number, if I cross multiply with a positive number, then sign of inequality will not change. Now tell me, if suppose 1 upon x less than 1 is written and I am doing cross multiplication, so here I will get 1 and here I will get x. Now can anyone tell me that which one will be greater? Can I put the inequality sign like this or this? Yes, Anjali, Hanok, you are correct. Ji Chaturi and Santosh, you are not correct. No, Santosh, not correct. See, please focus here. If I do cross multiplication by x, then how to put the sign of inequality? We don't know. Why? Because see, if x is positive, then sign of inequality will not change. But suppose if x is negative, then by doing the cross multiplication, the sign of inequality will change. Now see, everyone please see, we don't know whether this x is positive or not. We don't know whether this x is positive or negative. That's why we cannot determine that the sign of inequality will change or not. Is it clear? Please listen again. We don't know the sign of x. We don't know whether this x is positive or negative. That's why after cross multiplication, we are not sure that the sign of inequality will change or not change. That's why we cannot say anything. That's why we will not do cross multiplication. Okay. Why we cannot do the cross multiplication? Because after doing cross multiplication, we don't know how to put the sign of inequality. That's why we cannot do the cross multiplication. But here, see another example. If I'm writing 1 upon x square plus 2 less than 1. Now I'm sure I can surely do the cross multiplication. Why? Because see everyone, this x square plus 2 is always positive. Why this x square plus 2 is always positive? Please listen carefully everyone. This x square is always positive. This is a perfect square and you have studied till class 10th that a perfect square is always positive. And if it is added to 2, then this whole will be a number which will be greater than 2. And hence I can say this will always be positive. And hence if I do the cross multiplication, then we know very well that sign of inequality will not change. And I can do the cross multiplication here. So from all these examples, what conclusions are we drawing? We are drawing the conclusion that we have to avoid cross multiplication in inequality. You can do the cross multiplication when the function to be cross multiplied is positive. See here, this x square plus 2 is always positive. That's why we can do the cross multiplication. Sign of inequality will not change. But if you don't know the sign of this x, whether it is positive or negative, then you cannot do the cross multiplication because you will not be able to know that the sign of inequality will change or not. So is it understood or not? So that's why I'm going to write it as, see, avoid cross multiplication inequality. It can be done. When it can be done? It can be done if the function to be multiplied, it can be done if the function to be multiplied is positive. Yes. So, do you understand the first precaution? Yes, please reply me quickly. Only few students have replied. Reply me quickly, please. Do you understand the first concept, first precaution? Okay. Okay, see. Okay, now. Very nice. Now, you have not to just write this first precaution. But while solving the question, you have to keep this thing in mind. When I will give you questions in the inequality, then don't do cross multiplication. Be careful. Be careful always. Don't do the cross multiplication. You can do the cross multiplication only when the function to be multiplied is positive. So now I am moving to the second precaution in the next page. So have you written this or not? I am removing this thing because you don't need to write this. This is the first precaution. And for this first precaution, you have to write just these two examples only. So have you written? Should I move to the next precaution? Tell me quickly, should I move to the next precaution or not? Okay. Okay. So very interesting. Now I'm asking again a question from you. Everyone, please give me the answer. Okay. If I write x equal to root 4, everyone please answer. If I write x equal to root 4, then the value of x will be what? Please reply quickly. Okay, Anjali is saying plus minus 2. Anok is 2, Tejasvi 2, Santosh 2, and Hinduja plus minus 2, Ajit 2, Jaisankar 2. Okay. Some of the students are saying plus minus 2 and some are saying only 2. So only 2 or plus minus 2? Listen everyone, please. Listen everyone. If I write x equal to root 4, then it will be only plus 2, not plus minus 2. So from now onward, always be careful. If it is written in any problem that x equal to root 4, then its value is only 2. Yes, it is not plus minus 2. Correct. Now see, so why it is only 2? I'm explaining it. Just listen and write the second precaution. The second precaution is square root. See everyone, square root is always positive. Okay, always remember, square root is always positive. Okay, so this square root 4, it will not be plus minus 2. It will always be positive. Its value will be only plus 2. Again, further, I am explaining it further. Okay, don't worry. You will have no doubts at the end. Suppose if I write x square is equal to 4, then do you know the answer of this x square is equal to 4 will be x equal to plus minus 2. Here the answer will be plus minus 2. If x square equal to 4, the answer will be plus minus 2. But here if it is written x equal to root 4, then the answer will be only 2. Listen please carefully. The square root is always positive. Okay, it cannot be negative. The plus minus which you are looking here comes by the mathematical process, not because of the square root. This plus minus sign comes here not by the square root. This plus minus comes here only by the mathematical process, not by this square root. This square root is always positive. How it comes, how this plus minus comes by the mathematical process? See, I am solving it. I am factorizing it by writing x minus root 4 into x plus root 4 is equal to 0. Okay, I am factorizing it. I know root 4 is 2, but still I am not writing 2 to make you understand properly the concept. Okay, if I equate it to 0, then I will get x equal to root 4. And if I equate it to 0, then I will get x equal to minus root 4. So here I will get x equal to plus minus root 4. So what I want to tell you is the plus minus sign comes by the process of mathematics, by the process of algebra, not because of this square root. this square root is always positive. So always remember this thing, that square root is always positive. Another way of explaining it is that it is, see, x equal to root 4, x equal to 2. It is a linear equation. Its degree is 1. Degree means power of x is 1. So it will have only one root. It will not have two root. Here, it is a quadratic equation. Here, degree of the equation is 2. Power of the variable x is 2. So here, two roots will come. And that's why here plus minus 2 are coming. So in these two ways, I am explaining the concept. And what is the concept? The concept is square root is always positive. Is it clear or not? Do you understand or not? Okay, Anjali, nice. Okay, now. Okay, very good. So again, I'm asking you a question. Please everyone focus and give me the answer. If I ask, what will be under root of x square? Yes, tell me, what will be under root of x square? Okay, so everyone is telling me the answer is x. Santosh, Vahini, Hanok, Tejasri, Anjali, Gayatri, Chatur, Ajit. Oh, everyone is telling me the answer is x. Okay, so till class 10th, yes. Up to the class 10th, definitely the answer is x. Under root of x square is yes, x. Because under root means power 1 by 2 and this 2 gets cancelled out and this x. Up to the class 10th, the answer is x, correct. But if you are moving in class 11th, then x is not correct. Why not correct x? Why this x is not correct? See, what I told you here, this square root is always positive. And if you write x, then can you say that this x is always positive? No, you cannot say, no. You cannot say this x is always, this x can be negative also. Yes? So now, so listen everyone. Since square root is always positive, if you put under root of x square is x, then you are not sure that whether this x will be positive or negative. That's why, since, listen everyone, please focus here. Since square root is always positive, that's why to make this x positive, I put mod sign, modulus of x. Okay, so this concept will be used in the whole 2 years of preparation. Remember, and from now, never make a mistake. Under root of x square is not x, it will be mod x. Okay, now, if you have understood, then tell me what will be under root of sine square x. Yes. What will be under root of sine square x? Yes, very nice. Now, very nice. Good, good. Gayatri, still you are making mistake. And rest of the students are giving me very nice, very good. See, okay, see, it will not be sin x because a class 10th student will answer sin x. But you are in class 11th now. So you know that square root is always positive. So make it always, to make it always positive, I have to put modulus sign here. Now, one more example. Tell me the value of under root of x square minus 6x plus 9. Do it quickly. Under root of x square minus 6x plus 9. What will it be? Under root of x square minus 6x plus 9. Okay, Vijay Kumar, correct. Chatur Teja, not x plus 3, it is x minus 3. Santosh, correct. Very good. See, it is under root of x square minus 6x plus 9 is x minus 3 whole square. And if I take under root of x minus 3 whole square, I will get x minus 3, not x minus 3, but mod x minus 3. Why I had put mod here? To make it always positive. Up to class 10th, your answer would have been x minus 3. But here, your correct answer will be mod x minus 3. So now I think you have understood the meaning of precaution number 2. The precaution 2 is square root is always positive. And that's why after taking a square root to make it always positive, we have to put mod. Okay. Should I move to precaution number 3? Although I will move in the next class. So that's why today I will not forget to save the PDF of this. Yes, I have saved it. Okay. So we'll do the precaution number 3 in the next class. Precaution number 3 and 4. And after that, we will solve questions on the inequality. I will tell you the methodology. Okay. So let's meet in tomorrow's class with precaution number 3. So thank you, everyone. Okay. Thank you, Anjali. And yes, please, everyone is requested to join the class at sharp 10 a.m. Please. Yes, everyone is requested to join the class at sharp 10 a.m. Please. Okay. Okay. Thank you.